Good morning. I'm Aaron Heiser of Maker's Leather Supply, and today we're going to play doctor. I realize that anybody watching that's probably some of my closest friends, they got a little excited right there, but what I really meant was we're going to make a doctor bag. This doctor bag was featured in last month's mystery box, so we're getting the video out and ready. So probably be a couple of different videos just due to length and things like that, and making it easier for people to look up what they need. In this video, the one we're going to make, we are going to hand sew the entire bag. I'm using a different leather than what I used on this. I'll still use the russet tooling leather from Wicked Craig on the tops and everything, but I'm using a nice brown oil tan for the main body here. In the mystery box, we put a different style of handle. It's just a one-piece handle that doesn't have this piece right here. This right here is how we're going to go forward with this pattern, making our handles this way, because I like the versatility of having the D-rings on them, so that they're going to last a lot longer than leather, you know, folding over like that. I apologize for that. For the mystery box, it's one of those things, the more of them I build, the more of them I'm like, oh yeah, maybe we should adjust this a little bit. So anyway, other than that, it has a lock fastener right here holding it closed, and then this one, I got the rivets a little tight, so it doesn't open as easily. I did line this one. To line it, very simple. We'll talk about it throughout the video, but basically you just sew or glue a lining to the inside as you sew all the pieces together. So anyway, without further ado, we will we'll get this thing going. Again, that one is my fancy. I wanted to use, you know, super crazy leather and all kinds of stuff on it. We're going to have this thing available for purchase in a variety of different, like what I'd like to do. I'm not 100% sure on this yet, but we're looking at doing one where you can just buy the pattern and the hardware together, or one where you can just buy the set of hardware, or one that you could buy the entire kit, like what came in the mystery box. But there's the pattern right there. I'm holding it upside down. That doesn't help anybody. So in the pattern, we've got our tooling pieces. We can see the whole thing there. Got our tooling pieces. There's that little top piece that holds the lock fastener on it. You're gonna cut out two of these end pieces right here. There's the side with all the marks of where things get sewn down. And there's the bottom piece. You cut out two of that side, by the way. And then there is the tooling pattern supplied to us by our good friend, Don Gonzalez. I know I mention him almost every video because he helps us out a lot, but Don has a website, dgsaddlery.com, and also a YouTube channel where he does lots of great teaching and makes some really cool projects, and he has a lot of patterns and stuff available as well for free or for purchase. So I've already cut out all my pieces, so I'm going to put this away, but on the pattern it says what, like, thicknesses and types of leather you should use for each of those. And I did go ahead and cut mine out because I also wanted to go ahead and stamp up my pieces. I'm not a huge fan of floral carving. I just don't enjoy doing it. So this is probably the only one I'll ever use Don's carving pattern on personally, because, well, I already tooled it once. I don't want to tool it again. So I sat down yesterday. I had my pieces already cut out. And so I sat down and I stamped the heck out of these things with a Barry King stamp that we have available. I do like this stamp. It's honestly the first time I'd ever used it in any kind of extensiveness, I guess you could say. I'm not very good at geometric stamping, so I'm kind of forcing myself to do a lot more of it so that I can get better. I know I just said I don't like floral tooling. Now I'm not good at geometric. Like, what do you do, Aaron? Well, I just like carving cool stuff. So anyway, so I've got my four strap hangers is what I'm going to call them. And then I've got my two top pieces there, and I haven't done anything to this yet, but it's gonna have my maker's mark right here, and I might do a border around it. I haven't decided yet. As previously stated, I am going to hand sew this entire bag during this video. That being said, don't roll your eyes just yet. I'm not going to force you to watch me hand sew this sucker. I just want you to know that that's what's going to happen. So here is my oil tan pieces. I'm gonna go ahead and take the camera down. Here are my oil tan pieces right here. Again, I've got two main handle pieces. I'll show you a neat little trick that I did on that bag that I just showed you. Then I've got my two side pieces here. This is my bottom piece right here. And then I've got my two side pieces here. Now, when we were clicking out all the mystery boxes, I found one that had a really cool brand on it. I personally love using a brand, but some people don't, so I set it aside and did not send it out in someone's mystery box, because it's just my luck. Someone that, you know, doesn't like using brands would have ended up with it, and yeah. And then I've got a scrap piece of leather over here because we actually have just a couple of more things we'll have to cut out for this thing. I thought I had the bars for this thing sitting over here, but I must be wrong. Anyway, the metal bars that this thing comes with are 16 inches wide. They're held together by rivets. Once we're done with putting everything else together, we'll put those rivets in there. And yeah, we're gonna get busy on this thing. So the first thing that I need to do, these end pieces here, I need to skive down that top part of those, and I want to roll it over so it has a nice rolled finished edge on it. Okay. I'm going to do that to both of these. I'll skive them, I don't know, 3/4 of an inch down or so. It doesn't really matter, but there is, if you don't skive and roll those top edges, you do need to cut a quarter to a half inch off of them, or they're going to be too big for the bag when it's finished. I'm also going to skive along the very bottom edge of my two side pieces, where they're going to join up to the bottom piece. Okay, so when this thing's done, like, there's my bottom, here's my sides. I want that brand facing the right way. Okay, I will end up sewing these slightly overlapping by about 1/4 of an inch. So I just need to skive a little bit off of these bottom pieces to make sure that I've got a nice transition seam right there. Okay, so again, 1/4 inch over here too. We're not sewing that part together yet because we have to sew the tops on these things. And I want to put my handle, my strap hangers on it. And it's a lot easier to sew all that together while you're just holding two little sides than when you've got the whole bag already half assembled. So, yeah, I'm going to go over to the skiving machine right quick and skive those areas I just talked about. And when I return, we will start doing a little bit of sewing and putting this thing together. All right, so I went ahead and skived these pieces. And I skived a little bit off the top here as well. It's about 3/4 of an inch wide. And then down here, it ended up being a little bit closer to 3/8 of an inch as opposed to 1/4. It's fine. I didn't set my machine right, and that's okay. It's not going to hurt anything at all. But the reason I skived this part down is because this is going to sew to this, which is going to sew to the leather that's wrapped around the bars. And since I'm hand sewing all this, I just thought, you know what, let's skive it down a little bit, and we'll have a much nicer, thinner edge right there. But then also, it just is going to make hand sewing a little bit easier that it's a little bit thinner there, because there's going to be several layers of leather right there sewn together. And when hand sewing, it's a lot easier to keep it straight and a lot easier to get your awl through it if it's not crazy thick. So, that's what we did. Okay. It doesn't really matter what order I do this in, but I think I'm going to go ahead and sew these top pieces to their respective where they're going to go. Okay, so that one there and that one there. And all I'm going to sew at this time is just the bottoms of them right here. Okay, now I can glue this down, I can tape this down, I can do whatever, but I also want to make sure that I finish my edges on this before I do any of that. Because, you know, once this is sewn to this, there's no chance you're going to get to finish that bottom edge again. That's it. So I am going to quickly work on those edges right quick. I'll do one of them on the camera so you can see. And then the other one I'll do off camera so that you don't have to watch again. I'm going to use my Ron's Edge Rub and a piece of canvas. I'm not going to dye these edges. I want them to be natural just for the contrast. And since I didn't put any finish on them or anything, normally if I put finish on this, like an antique or something, it gets onto the edges. And that's when I dye my edges darker, is because I want to hide that. But I didn't use anything like that. As a matter of fact, I actually forgot to put any kind of finish on these. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to oil them really well with my indelible finishing all up here. My little bottle of indelible conditioning oil, and I actually do need to oil all these pieces since I tooled them up yesterday, or stamped them up, and I spraying them with water, letting them dry, spraying them with water, letting them dry, all that stuff during the stamping process. It really takes its toll on the leather. So if we give it a little bit of oil, it'll really do nicely. This may be the only finish I put on this. I don't like shiny leather very much. For most applications, so I may just make this nice and natural, kind of like a saddle, so that you know, it can be oiled over the years and stuff like this. Kind of doing this one is more of a a utility type case. I mean, I've got my pretty one back there that I already tooled up and all that stuff, and this would be more for, you know, maybe a vet or something like that. I usually will make something like this, and then within a year I find somebody that could use it more than I could, and I end up just giving it away. I don't know what purpose they might use it for, so I'll just oil it instead of putting all the pretty shiny stuff on it. Anyway. This leather will come back to its a lighter color again. I'm just putting a real nice saturating coat of oil on it. Do not over oil your leather. I was helping a guy some years ago making a rifle scabbard. I told him, hey, take it home over the weekend and put a couple of coats of oil on it. You know, and I just meant put a coat like this, tomorrow put another coat like this, the next day put another coat like this. And when this dude brought this thing back to me, I'm not joking, you could like wring the oil out of it. It was really, really oily. We couldn't get anything to stick to it, to help it stick together. You know, while we were sewing it and stuff like that. Even the sewing machine where the presser foot would press on it, like you'd just see a puddle of oil come up. I mean, it was really oily. I'm going to grab a paper towel so I can wipe off the mess I just made with that oil. And I need to put my maker's mark on the last piece so that I can oil it as well. So I got to put my maker's mark on here. Now, this thing's going to hang, drape kind of over the top of the bag. So let's say I was going to do someone's initials or something like that. I mean, technically this would be the front of the bag, but you've got a lot of surface area back here. So if I was going to put someone's initials on it, I would probably do it back here and it would look really nice. Since this bag's not specifically being made for anybody, I'm gonna put my maker's mark on it, because I love my maker's mark. And I want to decorate the world with my maker's mark, because I like it so much. So, this maker's mark was made by Tim Purdy at Steel Stamps Incorporated. This is my first steel stamp. I always wanted one, but honestly, while I was in the military and stuff, my maker's mark changed every time I moved, and I didn't want to invest in a steel stamp. They are kind of costly. But I didn't want to invest in one because, again, in 2 years when I moved again, it would change. So I'm just kind of eyeballing the center here. I'm going to go ahead and grab my little centering ruler I've got sitting here and make sure this thing's in the middle. That's pretty close to middle. And I'll just beat it down. I smile every time I put this thing on some leather. It is a large surface area stamp, so I'm going to rock it to the right just a tiny bit. Sorry, that's the left. One more again. There we go. So, there it is. I love that thing. Now, I need to oil that once it dries up a little bit. I've got some time because it's going to sew onto this later on. Now I'm also going to want to stitch around this. I might line it, but if you do line it, you need to be very, very careful. Like I'm going to use this LOX fastener, and that's what will be included in the hardware sets for these things. Now I lined the very first one I made, not paying attention to the thickness, the total thickness of it, and I had one hell of a good time trying to get my LOX fastener in far enough that I could put the washer on the bottom. And not only do you need to be able to get the washer on the bottom, it needs to screw in until it is flush with the bottom piece of this, so that it'll actually have enough room to snap onto your little snap. And so I'm not kidding, underneath the one I made, underneath both this piece and this piece, I did tons of skiving and working, and the little key that you use to install these, I actually bent three of them because I was using pliers to try to tighten that damn thing on there enough, and it just got ridiculous trying to get them on there. So, if I line this, I'm going to make sure I line it with something super duper duper thin, because I don't want to go through that again, ever. Oh my gosh, that was really... Like, I was about to cry because I wasn't sure if I was going to get the damn thing on or not. And, I'd worked pretty hard on all that thing, so I didn't want to take that piece back off. So, anyway, what I meant was I wasn't about to cry because I'm a big, tough man and I don't do that, right? All right. Get the LOX fastener put back together and over there so I don't lose any parts. So, again, I need to finish my edges, okay? I'm going to use my Ron's Edge Rub here. I'm going to use a number 2 edger. This is 6 to 7 ounce russet tooling leather from Wicket Craig. I say tooling, technically it's skirting, and they split it down. There is a little bit of a difference between skirting and regular tooling leather. I don't actually know what that difference is, but I usually just call it tooling leather so that people don't get confused and they don't think that they can't use it because it has the word skirting there. Skirting generally is made for saddle work. And so a lot of folks, myself included back in the day, would get really confused and think that, oh, I can't use that, that's not the right leather for me. So the only part that I'm going to finish at this time is going to be this bottom, the scalloped edge of these two, and then I'm going to go all the way around all of these pieces. And again, I will I'll just do one on camera here. And then I'll finish the rest off camera. Shake this stuff up. This stuff kind of separates sometimes. There's lots of other finishes, edge finishes that we sell here, but this is the fastest one for video purposes. So that's the one I'm using today. People ask me all the time about this little applicator jar. I don't sell them, but you can get one directly from Ron's Tools. Reason I don't sell them is because they're kind of pricey for what it is, which is, you know, a little plastic canister with a couple of brushes in it. So anyway, I don't sell them because, you know, by the time I bought them and then had to like make a profit margin on them, they'd just get all kinds of ridiculous. So if you want one, go to Ron's and get you one. Toby over there would love to help you out. All right, so using my canvas here, I'm just gonna do some light burnishing on each of these little sections until they look nice and burnished. Not hard to achieve. A lot of the time I'll get it about halfway burnished and then I'll move on to the next section, just so that that stuff doesn't set up too much, the Ron's Edge Rub. And then I'll come back to it and finalize my burnishing afterward. It works great that way. So, back to the first piece again. Go back over it with a fresh area on my little burnishing rag here. And I'm not worried about the roundness very much of this edge, just because of the idea that it is going to be sewn against something flat, so it just doesn't matter. So there that one is, good and burnished, pretty edge. It's gonna look great on this case. Again, I'm gonna pause the video. I will burnish all four of these, and I will, I'm not gonna burnish that last piece yet, because like I said, I may go find me a really thin piece to line it with. And yeah, so I don't wanna burnish it unless it's already lined. So, pause it we are. All right, so those are all burnished now, all the way around on these, and then I just burnished the bottom part of this one and this one, because when we sew it to the side, we're gonna wanna do the sides of it afterward to try to marry up those two sides as nicely as we can, or those two edges. So yeah. All right, so I'm gonna take one of my bag sides here, and I'm going to figure out where all this stuff's gonna go. And if you have the one piece handle and you're doing it that way, like what was in the mystery box, you wanna go ahead and do what we just did and burnish up your handle and your edges regardless, because this is when we're going to figure out where these things all sew onto the bag. Now, this is the front of the bag, because it's going to have this big brand on it. And here I'm going to take, okay, you see that one of these has a big wide portion on it, one of them has a narrow portion on it. Now the narrow portion is where the lock fastener is going to end up being. Okay, notice the difference in the oiled versus the unoiled. This will still lighten up a little bit more, but it's about going to be that color. So oil is a beautiful thing. All right, so I'm working on the front of the bag right now. So what I'm going to do is use the part where this is more narrow, as opposed to where it's wider. The wider piece, so I'll just set over there on that back piece and push it away. Now I can glue this down, I can tape this down, I can do all kinds of stuff, depending on what kind of leather I'm using. This is an oil tan here, so glue is not going to work the best. It will work, but it's not going to work really, 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 really well. So what I'm going to go ahead and do is I'm going to grab some double-sided tape, and I'm going to just tape this thing into position, And mainly, I guess I could go ahead and sew it down, but one of the things I'm trying to do is find the position for my handle pieces. I want my handles, since this has the scallops in it, the handles look best directly under the little points of the scallops, just like that. It's just the way that they seem to look best to me. If you want to bring them in or move them out or whatever, you can. But no matter if you're doing the actual, just the one piece handle or doing the strap hangers like this, that's where we're at. I want them right directly under that, probably about an inch from the point is where I'll sew that sucker down. Grab me some of my wider double-sided tape here. And I'm going to put some tape on the back of that sucker. Scissors. One of the things I like about my new shop is everything is where I can reach it from this bench for the most part, and so I don't have to, you know, walk across the room to get a tool, and that helps the videos a lot, and it helps me a lot, so really enjoying the new shop over here. Alright, so there's that. I'm just going to set that off to the side for a second. If you're using these, now you got to keep in mind that you're going to shove a piece of leather up under here later. So you don't want to put any tape or glue in this general area right here. I'm going to put all of it down here and maybe a little bit on the edges right here so that I can stick it accurately onto the leather. But if I put glue or tape right there, then I won't be able to get my strap in there behind it like I need to later. Another thing that will help you if this was cut out on a clicker die like this one was, it's gonna be kind of beveled in. Well, even if you punch that with your by hand, it's gonna be beveled in a little bit. I'm gonna take my edger and I'm going to just edge bevel the bottom part of that slot right there, okay, and that's going to help me too to be able to slide a piece of leather under there later. So, and I'm going to bevel it pretty good, and again, that's really going to help later when I go to push that leather in there, which is, it's going to be one of the last things we do in the bag, but that's, it's also going to be way too late to find out then that how difficult it could be to push that under there. So. Okay. All right, so I'm going to go ahead and stick this down. Again, I'm making sure if you have any specific way you want to orientate yours, such as my brand, you got to make sure that your top is facing up and your bottom's facing down, so that you can get this sucker on here right. And so, pull my tape. And then I'm going to carefully line up my edges, more carefully than that. All right, and I'll just press it down. Depending on, you know, when you tool this, make sure you put some tape on it or something, because I know it's too late to say that now. Hopefully you're watching this before you build. But anyway, when you tool these, make sure you tape them, because if they're, you know, the ones that we cut out for you with on the clicker, then they, as you tool them, if they stretch, then they're not going to fit on there as nicely as what we just did here. Yeah. So now I'm going to take my stitch groover and I'm going to do a stitch line just across the bottom of the scallop. Okay, the sides and the top will be done later as this bag is sewn together. You know, the sides are sewn on and things like that, but right now I'm just going to do this bottom edge right here. And one of the reasons I'm hand sewing this bag is because once we get into doing the bars, the metal bars that are in it and stuff, it's very difficult to do on a machine. I did the other one on the machine, and honestly, I think it would have looked nicer if I hand sewed it. But I'll get to all that, the areas that, you know, if you want to do stuff on a machine, I'll show you how, or tell you how I did it. But I think I'm going to hand sew because I think I can do a better job. All right, running a stitch groover on scallops is never fun, but I'll do what I can. I'm going to sew this, I think, 7 stitches per inch. With 0.8 millimeter thread will probably work out really nicely. I know on all my wallets and stuff like that, I always do 8 stitches per inch, but this is a big project, and that extra stitch per inch. Very important when you're going around curves and things like that with a stitch groover, always try to keep the groover exactly the same length, width, you know, like you've got to angle the head of the groover with the angles that you're using, otherwise your stitch groove won't perfectly follow your contours that you need it to. There we go. Now while I've got this groover out, I'm going to go ahead and groove around all of these. I don't necessarily need to do it on camera, so I'm going to pause the video, and when I come back, just know that all 4 of these will be grooved, and I might as well, since I'm in the grooving spirit, go ahead and groove the bottom line of this one as well. And yeah, when we come back, we'll get to stitching. All right, we are back. So I went ahead and grooved the corresponding areas on this piece, and then I went ahead and grooved all 4 of these pieces. So I am going to run my overstitch wheel again. I'm going to use my 7 stitches per inch. I think that's this one right here. Yep. I'm going to run my overstitch wheel, my stitch marking thing here, across here, and I'm going to get to hand sewing this sucker. Now, I've done videos where I did all the hand sewing and stuff on camera and all that, and I just don't really feel the need to make you watch it right now. So what I'm going to say is, tomorrow morning there will be the second video of this posted, and by the time that's posted, we should have this sewn to this one sewn to this, just on the bottoms, okay? And then also our either handles or strap hangers, we're going to put about 3/4 inch below that that scallop, pointy scallop part there, okay? Now, if your handle is just the straight handle, and you're going ahead and sewing that part down right now, I will tell you this. I took a piece of like 6 to 7 ounce and cut it about 1/2 inch wide and stuck it in there and folded this over it. And it made a really nice, more rigid handle. I didn't finish the edges on this piece here, but anyway, you can see that core in there, that's actually veg tan inside there, and it made a really nice handle. You can just fold it over and sew it to itself if you don't have something like that, but if you've got any kind of scrap leather that you can cut a piece out of that'll fit in there, again, it was 1/2, maybe 3/4 inch wide. You can always cut it too wide, fold the handle over it and glue it all up, and then you can trim it off after you sew it. I don't have to worry about sewing my handles together right now because, again, I'm just using these strap hangers. So I am going to sew these strap hangers and these scallop pieces onto the main body here, And tomorrow we will sew the main body pieces together. And we're going to worry about how we're going to do our special gusset. This will entail, if you got the mystery box, there was an extra like scrap of leather in there. And that's where we're going to start cutting some of those pieces out. So, for your homework, I guess you could say, go ahead and sew these things together. And tomorrow morning there will be a new video and we'll move on with the next part of this bag. So, till then, again, I'm Aaron Heiser of Maker's Leather Supply. Thank you very much for watching. If you want to get notifications of our videos, feel free to subscribe to our channel. We probably have over 10,000 subscribers now, and I just never in my life would have thought that would ever happen. Anyway, have a great day. We'll see you soon.